I think we should remember again and again that because the photons move at the speed of light, and it was learned from Einstein that if something moves at the speed of light, no time passes within the clock moving with that photon. So we can imagine the photon has a clock, and that clock can go. But if the photon moves at the speed of light, the clock doesn't move. So when it is produced in the sun within a nuclear process of fusion, and when it enters our eye and produces a perception in our eye, that happens for the photon at the exactly same moment.
And there is the same place. So the sun is in your eye, and your eye is on the sun.
This is the mystery which I heard from you before, but which I did not understand, really.
Space and time.
The same is part of a mystery of the ancient Greeks. They considered the eye to be the sun. And it was picked up by Goethe, our poet here, that this is the place of the sun, this eye. So, but how it works, I couldn't understand.
And if you see the $1 bill of USA dollars, you know, on the top of the pyramid, there's a small triangle, and there's an eye there, and there's a rays going out from there like the sun. So it is in the system, this philosophy, this part of there. If you have anybody at $1 bill, you will see on the top there's a small triangle with an eye in the center and the rays going all around from there.
Okay, this comes to conspiracy.
I will address this in a few minutes. Okay. Now, John made a calculation of two photons meeting each other and then getting twisted in such a way that a positron and an electron would be produced. And these two particles, he can describe in the form of a tensor, means it is an array of or a setting of numbers with 16 degrees of freedom. So we can also say 16 dimensions, but we have to be careful that we should not try to imagine 16 dimensions visually in space. That's not what is meant. Well, you have only three dimensions in space, finished. You cannot imagine them to be 5, 6, or 8, or 10, but in a mathematical way, you can produce degrees of freedom practically as much as you want.
Well, we're limited to the 16, but the degrees of freedom are just things like rotations.
Yes. It's not mysterious. That's very clear.
You can rotate that plant. Look, easy. Rotate. That's what some of these people call dimensions. They like to make it sound complicated. It is a little more complicated than that.
Yeah. So, and he would put in that tensor 16 lines.
Phases. You can say phase.
No.
Each line is one.
I mean,
phase.
Now. Okay, but these 16 are composed. Okay, please.
Just want to check so that you're saying that these 16 dimensions are not special dimensions, they're just degrees of freedom.
Yeah.
But these 16 tensors are then going to describe relationships between these spatial and time dimensions.
Yes.
So there's a lot of subtlety there.
There's a huge amount of subtlety in terms of what you can do with it.
But it's not suggesting that the relationship between the dimensions that we're familiar with, that there's something subtle going on in that, and that's what it's describing.
It's certainly the case that the dimensions that we're familiar with, the dimensions we see around us, are not the dimensions which create the dimensions. those space and time things create other groups of three-dimensional objects, four of them superimposed on one another, which form the three-dimensional room in which we're living. So what Euclid called a dimension wasn't a dimension. It was a degree of freedom, 3D things, and not dimensions, although they're called dimensions. And you see, I can say it's not a dimension, but who am I to contradict Euclid? So the problem is you're using a word, dimension, in many different senses at the same time. A lot of words have this problem. And I'm using English at the moment. If you could switch language, it would help people since then it's human and German or something. So it doesn't help. All humans have got the same problem. So when we're talking about this, you always have to say what you're not saying rather than try to say what you're saying. And one has to describe it in a nasty way where you have to give all the corollaries all the, and make sure that people don't think we've got some horrible 16-dimensional thing. How do you do that?
That's probably
the answer is you don't, because you show a picture and everybody gets that it's three-dimensional and then has spent the rest of the time trying to work out why it's not. Why is this idiot telling me that it's not, but I can see what it is? You see what I mean? And that's just the way it is.
There's probably a ton of really useful Sanskrit terms here waiting to be...
Sanskrit, if we have a language, any language, which distinguishes properly, because degrees of freedom is three words, and what's that about?
Actually, in Sanskrit, it is worse because they like to use 100 meanings for one term.
Oh, that was a game.
No.
There
is a huge.
In Sanskrit, for every detail, there is a separate term. For this one, what you're talking is kala, K-A-L-A. Kala.
But is that degree of freedom then, or dimension?
Yeah.
I should say, all this stuff's not being taught in English, it's being taught in Dutch. We work in Dutch because it's more precise.
Okay. So the 16 degrees of freedom would be, to be remembered, 3A regarding space, 3A regarding electric field, 3 regarding magnetic field, and 3 regarding momentum density. This makes together angular momentum density. So this makes together 12, and then there are additionally 4, and these 4, one of the 4 is time, then one is that it can be folded inward or outward like eagle type, inward, reverse, and the third one is a dual scala, and now the important one is the simple scala named as a pivot. Pivot is that point where it circulates around, the key thing. So that pivot now becomes the topic of the next consideration, and it is considered an invariant scala. Scala means it has no dimension. Dimension again in another meaning. It comes almost like rasa dada. Yeah, I mean, dimension is kg or meter per second or joule, kilojoule.
That's another kind of dimension.
So, and this pivot will change the flow of the electromagnetic momentum. This is to be remembered. And then he presented his electron and positron model. You remember it was a double loop. But not like in Richard. In Richard's, it was going like this, and then it was going inside again and again outside. And here it goes like this, and again like this, and then in the same, and again in the same. So it, two loops closed, but almost in one plane, not like
no.
this. Mukti was starting with three physical experiments. One of the experiments was the double slit experiment, which to my knowledge is nicely explained if we consider the light to be of a wave function, to be a wave function. But if you consider the light to be made of photons, not as a wave, then it is difficult to understand the double slit experiment. Is it like that? So she tried to find answers for that view.
It's right at the intermediate level, yes. But at the top level, then everything's at the same point, so then so the way it goes, there is at the same place.
Yeah. Okay, but in school we already learned the double slit experiment, and it is taught by a wave front going to the slits, and at the slits two new wave fronts will be produced, and they are interfering and producing a pattern on the screen. That's what we learned.
Well, what it is, it's both a wave, and that wave is there, but it's also a particle because the whole thing is at the same point.
That's the problem. If you don't consider it as a wave front, but take it as a photon, then you go in trouble. And how?
And the first you can do both. Photon is here, goes from here to here. What happens in between doesn't matter because they're all at the same point. So it can be a wave. We see a wave. It sees a particle. It's both a wave and a particle. It's the right way to look at it. And it's not the wave.
Okay. The next experiment was a so-called entanglement experiment, and the third one was holographic experiments. In which you cut out a piece of the that hologram, and it again produces the whole image. And then there were a few. Yeah, there was the assumption that eventually these phenomena can be explained by the action of microvita. She said that microvita could eventually be understood as acting in a web of entangled particles, being in contact with each other, regardless of the distance that separates them. And she concluded that this universe is a participatory universe, and the cosmic nucleus is always connected with all its parts at the same time, in the same instant, with no time and space barriers. And then she pointed out that eventually telepathy might be based on quantum non-locality. And she proposed that microvita could be eventually understood as making fields. And another suggestion was that microvita might be tachyons. Yes, that's what I noted down. There was much more, but at least this I can summarize.